Hey guys, thanks for your patience. I'm here with a member of the Heroes development team. I'm going to let him introduce himself. His name is Kaéo Milker. Give him a warm welcome. Hey Kaéo, welcome to the stream. Yeah, I know. That's with a delay. They're sound right now.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kaéo Milker. I am the production director for Heroes of the Storm. It's so cool to be here with Grubby.
Well, thanks for taking some time out of your, must be sure, very busy schedule here at the Gamescom. I read some of your other interviews already. But I have a number of questions here. And there's the welcome. See, that's about the delay that we can expect. Hi, guys. So, I've got a bunch of questions from myself and from some
Greetings,
of my viewers.
Friend.
I'll be curious to
welcome
see
to the stream, D.
what answers we can get out of you.
All right, we'll try.
I want to start with a very much anticipated feature for Heroes of the Storm, Arena Mode. Last BlizzCon, you drove everyone's mind crazy with that, and we know it's gone through some iterations. What can you tell us, plainly speaking, about Arena now?
I think we just showed kind of the beginnings of Arena Mode at BlizzCon last year. I think we were really excited about it. We got a lot of great feedback on it. We took that back and we started trying to make improvements, adding additional maps, and we really took a step away from it and decided we really wanted to make it more of a full fleshed out game mode. So we're adding a lot of things to it, and we're going to have more information on it very soon here. So I know everyone wants it. We want it too. It's been a while since we talked about it.
And when you say very soon, is it like Blizzard soon, like still this year, or can we be like crossing our fingers already?
I think we can be crossing our fingers. Like there's no TM on the soon, if
wow.
that helps quantify it.
An like, actual soon, guys.
We're getting close. A legitimate soon.
That's pretty cool. Thanks for that.
Yeah.
One thing that some people have looked at with maybe even with envy, they see the Overwatch system, and there are custom games where people can use custom rules, all kinds of zany rules. Of course, Overwatch already has the ability to have multiple heroes in one game of the same kind on one team. But like, is there any chance that might ever happen in Heroes of the Storm?
I'm hearing more and more that people are liking that and that they think that would be valuable in the game. I think so many of the decisions we make are based on feedback we're getting from the community, from people like you who are streaming the game and playing it and getting your own feedback from your own audience. So I think if that's something that we all collectively think is valuable, then I think we could totally explore that.
Wow. Would it be like difficult implementation?
I think the basics of that, if we're just talking about a general set of rules that we can kind of have exposed to people in custom games, I think that is relatively easy. It still has to be prioritized against everything else we're doing, and there's some UI implications, and UI is the thing that always is our biggest bottleneck right now in terms of features.
Oh, because, sure, yeah.
We have a lot of stuff going on, and we're always jockeying things for position, but I think I've heard enough about this while I've been on this trip that I think I'm going to go back and talk to people about it and see if there's a starting point we can do, maybe expose a few of those things to you soon, TM, and then we can build on it from there. But if people have ideas of what they want to see in that, I really want to hear it.
That'll be really sick. Yeah. That's pretty exciting. Imagine, guys, you can join a custom game like Viewer Games where we can just have like all kinds of extraordinary roles. I think that'll be super fun. By the way, Chance is freaking out because Chu did a little bit of high.
Can we get individual
see Chu back
scores
there.
In MM? Much love for
right.
Hawks.
Well, really cool to hear. You mentioned prioritization. I see some Reddit threads and people will be like, this one thing that is really important to me personally and can just be done like that. Yeah. Why aren't you doing it?
Yeah.
And anytime there is an actual developer, may not be a Blizzard one, who comes in and he says, there are priority lists. Is there any tip of the veil that you can lift where we get an idea of like how many things are on your list?
Sure. Well, first I want to kind of explain the structure of how the team works, because I also see a lot of things where people will see something like a piece of content, a hero or a battleground, and they'll be like, instead of doing that, you should have done this feature that I really want or this little thing that we really want. But the way the team is split up, content is kind of its own pipeline, and it's fully staffed, and we're going. You know, we're delivering these heroes every 3 to 4 weeks. We have battlegrounds that we want to do every year, like the Machines of War stuff that we showed here. Features are an entirely different group of people. And we actually started with one feature pipeline, which meant we could only do one thing at a time, like literally could do one thing.
And what kind of categorization of features do you mean in that sense?
So this would be things like ranked play or matchmaking. It included when we did unranked draft and drafts and bans.
Oh, okay.
The progression system. These are all things like outside of content. We classify content as like heroes, skins, battlegrounds. That's content. Features are things that systems that are in the game that we're introducing.
So it isn't the sense that at some point you might have to say, okay, we're going to halt new hero production for 12 weeks because we want to roll out the new ranked. Yep. In the current structure, that's not the case.
Right, because most of the resources and the people who are dedicated to creating content today are not the people who would be making something like a big feature. We need server engineers and UI engineers, UI artists. There's a whole, just a different group of people. So we actually started with that one pipeline, though, for features, and now we have three pipelines. So it's three different distinct groups that end-to-end are making different features for the game. Each of those groups has a big list of things that they want to do within their own area of responsibility. There's also the global list of things that we want to do as a team. And there are hundreds of things on that list. It's all being prioritized in like real time. Like every day we meet and we look at those things. The individual teams kind of prioritize their lists. We prioritize at like a global scale across the team. And then we're looking at them and saying, here's this thing we really want, or this opportunity, this new idea, or this thing needs to be done. Like half of what we have to do is fixing bugs or reacting to things that are already live in the game. That's another challenge with this, is not only are we doing new things, but we also have this game that's a living, breathing thing. Yeah. And we keep touching it. And every time we touch it, we break something, or we introduce something else that needs more maintenance. And so the cost of that continues to go up. We've grown the team tremendously. Like, we started Heroes with three people. There's over 160 people on it today. So there's a lot there's a lot of moving parts to this, and it's never enough. Like, it never is. But I think when you look at all that stuff that we're trying to prioritize, the thing where you look at it and say, this is really small, and someone chimes in and says, this is easy, I could do this in a day. Like, yeah. Usually the things you can do in a day, we would do in a day, but then you got to look at, there's the validation part of that. Like, we can't just, one person doesn't change it and it goes in a game next day. There's a giant process that we have to go through to try to make sure that all these things actually work together and that we don't break our game, because it's a live game.
Okay.
But I think we're able to do a lot more now simultaneously than we were before. That means that we can do more big things than we were doing before, and it also means we get opportunities to insert the smaller things. So the biggest thing to me, and when I have people, when they have their thing that they want, that one thing that everybody wants, and sometimes they all want the same thing, that makes it a lot easier for us when we have consensus inside the team and amongst our community about what's important. But I mean, the more dialogue we have on that, the easier it is for us to prioritize that stuff, the higher the likelihood that we can get to the thing that more of us really want sooner.
And what is the best way for people to reach out?
We're looking across all channels. Like, I've been working at Blizzard for forever, for 15 years. I've never seen a team that I've worked on be this kind of engaged with the game that we're on. Like, we love our games, but Heroes is a game that we work on all day. We go home, we play it. I'm literally in games with Dustin every night, and Alan DeBerry, our tech director, Chris Figuer, our executive producer, members across the team from every role. We play it, and then we come back, and we're always talking about it. We're really passionate about it. So I think we're checked in. We're looking at your stream. We see your chat. We see the things they're saying there. Good and bad.
Oh my God, guys, they see
good
your
and
chat.
Bad.
Behave.
We hear you. You know, we're on Reddit. We're on our forums. We're getting tons of input also from our regions, from everywhere we are in the world. We have community teams, and we're gathering that information. It's a ton of input points, though. You know, there's a lot coming at us, but a lot of those things align, and a lot of those things we're able to kind of group up together and really understand how they interact and what the priority should be. That doesn't mean we can do them as fast as we would want to and as fast as you guys want them, but we're trying, and we love this game, and we keep pushing on it. And I think you see, like, we're really, really working hard on it, and it gets better every day.
I think everyone appreciates the rate of Hero release, for instance. That seemed to be a schedule that I personally thought it will be hard to keep it up, but you've delivered every 3 weeks. Pretty sick.
That's been it was a big thing. We tried during the technical alpha and the beta, we tried a bunch of different things, and we tried it for us, and we tried it for you guys, and we tried to figure out what felt good. That 3 to 4 week cadence is probably about the ideal. I know that right now there's 5 weeks between between Aria.
Isn't it true that there's going to be 2 weeks between Alarak and Zarya?
Yeah, so that's how those kind of compress. And really what happened there is we kind of ended up moving where our season roll date was, which was our patch date. So we ended up gaining a week. So I'm sorry that we gained a week. I would have liked to have had Alarak at the 4 week mark, which is where he was originally scheduled to go out. But yeah, so the good news is then you get another one.
Do we know the exact release dates for Zarya and Alarak?
Yeah, so we're going to PTR with the Machines of War content. So that will be the first map, which I believe is Braxis Holdout.
Okay, and when is that?
That will go out the week of August 29th. So last week, yeah.
That's PTR. So first week of September, we have him.
Well, so we actually are going, it's 2 weeks. So we're testing this for a little longer cycle this time. So that patch will hit, and the first battleground and Alarak will come in on the week of September 13th.
Very cool. Very cool.
So that's what's coming. And then 2 weeks later, we will have Zarya.
I'm just going to put that I am interviewing you in my stream broadcast.
Go for it.
Interview with Heroes Dev Team. Kaéo.
Should move so they can see Chu more.
That's no need.
What's that?
No, I'm not going to play for a little bit. Not until 8, I think. Okay, thanks. Just wanted to know if I was going to play. No, I'm not going to play now. All right, cool. Thank you. See what else I got. Butcher rework was announced to be coming. Do we have any ETA on that? Pretty short question.
Yeah, I'm actually not sure. Like, there's a lot of stuff in flight. I don't know exactly when it lands. It's okay. Something we could probably check and find out.
If you don't know, it's fine.
If it's locked in, I can get it to you. Okay. And you can tell them.
Okay. Cool. Some people wonder, do you ever want to move in the direction of some other games who show, for example, I think StarCraft does that now, show an accurate portrayal of your MMR, and maybe briefly, like, pros and cons?
We've been talking about it for a really long time. I think at this point, I think everyone knows StarCraft 2 and Heroes are this team one, same team, but we've split off now, completely different group of people working on them. But the Star 2 has gone the way to expose MMR. We've been talking about it a lot. We hear that. I think our current leaning is that we would like to do that, but we're having discussions about what does that entail. Is it only in ranked play? Should it be across the board? We know that people are using sites like Hotslogs and trying to get, you know, like a proxy of MMR because it's not complete. It's close. It's not exactly right. Yeah. And that they really want more data. They want to know more stats about their games, about the heroes, about the pick rates. They want to see all this stuff. We have that data. So this discussion of should we expose it, we're at the point now where we're like, I think we should expose it. And then we're having the discussions of how and when.
And is it like the main fear of, like, let's say, doing it? Would it be fair to say that it is to not want to make people feel bad?
I don't know if it was make something feel bad. I think, in general, MMR is a very static number. So it's something that generally it's just not moving much. It's just this thing. So we like to give you something that was the representation of it that we thought was a little meatier, something to grab onto. We started out with ranks. We weren't too happy with them. Neither were our players. We've gone now to our league system, which really mirrored what we've done in StarCraft 2 and what we've done before. So I think we're really happy with the rank rework and where that stuff is now. But we hear you that you want more data. You want hard numbers. And like I said, I think we're in agreement. We just need to hone in on the specifics of how we want to do that.
Okay. All right. And some people ask, I'm personally not familiar with this system from games, but they ask, is it possible to do a manual MMR reset, knowing that the alternative is creating a smurf? Because people sometimes want to feel like they have a fresh start.
Sure.
If even just to prove that there is a difference, or maybe to find out that there isn't, for their peace of mind. Can you just press a button and say, starting over, because
yeah,
you're still the same guy.
Sure.
So, like, in essence, you're playing and you're beating people worse than you, maybe, because you don't have MMR. Somewhere.
You're going to be, yeah. Because at first, we have to assume, we have to have a starting point for everybody when we know nothing about you. And then we very quickly start to diverge from that as we get information in your placement matches of where you actually are. If we reset that, it just creates total chaos. Because what you're generally going to find is you're going to land back somewhere where you are, because our systems are largely working well. There's a lot of little things and a lot of big things that we still are doing to improve them, but I think some of the tests people have been doing, and I don't condone some of the stuff that's gone on, where they've traded accounts and all that stuff, which we don't say to do that. But I think we've seen them kind of land back to where they were. Like, we've kind of...
But you have bashed so many newbies along the way.
Yeah, well,
you'll have such a good self-inflated ego.
Yeah, that's the crappy part. I don't know. Imagine being on the other end of that. I've
been on the other end of that, starting some shooter game and just getting my ass handed to me several times in a row.
Yeah, I don't know. So our solution so far is that we adjust the uncertainty for people. Like, at the season reset now, we're adjusting uncertainty. It may be something where we could give you an opportunity to adjust your uncertainty in intermediate times, not just at that, but... All that does is give you a little bit of time where if you're going to, like, go on a tear and, like, really kick ass, you could make more movement than you would have made. So, again, if you lose, you're going to drop even further. So, I don't know. Where do you think you're going to land there?
All right.
These are good things to talk about. We worked really hard on the matchmaking update, and we now have tools in our hands to make, like, constant improvements to the systems. So there's some that are, like, little tweaks, but there's also fundamental changes we can still make and keep making bigger and better Okay. MMR and matchmaking in general.
Pretty good general idea about it. Might revisit this topic if we still have time, but okay. I want to make sure we get to some of the other ones.
Cool.
Thank you. I have a few here. Can you answer this one? This one.
Sure.
I know it's a bit more of a gaming, the Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah.
Do you want to phase out 100% of the generic talents?
I think you're seeing us, like, slowly but surely phasing them out.
Yeah. I think we're like 50% of the way there, almost.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. We got a bunch of legacy work there already, but you know, we built the talent system because we wanted to get rid of the shop. We like this idea of per hero talents, where we can really give players a lot of customization, a lot of power to kind of direct the way they wanted to play a given hero. I think it's been a success. I think we keep getting better at it. I think when you look at our newest heroes and some of the changes we've been making to existing heroes, we're on the right path there. And I think we learn more every time. Like, every time we update a hero, every time we add a new hero.
I agree with that.
Yeah. So I think you will see us systematically revisiting old heroes, eliminating those generic talents, giving them custom ones. And we've been doing it pretty frequently. So look for that to keep coming.
I like the new spell shield. You can now choose whether the spell shield activates or not.
Yeah.
So it takes away the biggest complaint of spell shield, really. Yeah. You have no autonomy over it. Really cool. Okay. Are there any plans for Garrosh as a playable hero? There has been no announcement yet, so I'm assuming you can't say anything.
So we talk about this a lot. So any hero, any character from any Blizzard game ever is on the table.
Fair game.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we look at this. When I was talking about this mega list we have, this spreadsheet, and we sort it and we filter it and we look at everything in there. Garrosh is on there. I can't tell you when.
He's a cool hero. Yeah. He's on the list. Don't know when.
We agree. Yeah.
Okay. It could be like we really hate Garrosh. Like, we never want to see him again. Like,
most of our meetings are about bashing on Garrosh. He can't ever join the game.
But we need our villains too, right? Okay. Someone asked, he can't watch his first replay anymore because the game engine changed so much it's unwatchable. Is there any plan to watch that again?
Yes.
Can you patch back?
So we have like old replay support that we have in SR2. It's there. I think there's a lot of bugs with some of that stuff, so I won't say... I think that's a potential that we do that. I would imagine the work of that right now is behind some of this other really big meaty stuff that people want.
I would say so.
But I understand the desire to do that.
But what
it's
about
weird when these things become outdated and, they don't work anymore.
Okay.
I'll take that back with me.
Okay. Let's see. Someone said Gamescom released so much awesome content. Does that mean we can expect a superlative at BlizzCon? Will there be any huge announcements planned for Heroes?
BlizzCon is a really important time for us as a company. I think it's like the time where we gather together with like our most passionate players from all the games and our whole company. We actually, all the Blizzard employees work the show. It's like thousands of us and we're there, and pretty much everybody you see working the show these days at BlizzCon is going to be a Blizzard employee from wherever, whether it's from the dev teams or support teams, or we're all there. So we want to show good stuff at BlizzCon. And I think the last couple of years we've shown a lot of good stuff. Even though we've been talking about cool things here, that doesn't mean there won't be cool things at BlizzCon. There definitely will be. So I'm excited for BlizzCon. You guys are going to have to wait till November, though, to see all that.
Okay. Well, I have to hold our horses on that one. Pretty cool. Very specific game question. I got that a few times. Cindergoza, is it meant to freeze all the Zerg minions on the Zerg map? Brex sold out.
I saw the comments that were coming off of the floor here. So I haven't been in the office since last Sunday.
I'm not sure on the state of that, but I promise you we will look at that and you'll get a comment.
Claudio or someone will probably come on in and make some comments on that. But I'm not sure if it was intended or not.
Okay. Still have to review that, of course, because it's only...
Pretty strong. You guys wanted Arthas to be like super strong.
He's a Lich King or what, guys? Yeah. Come on. All right. Understood. Okay. People want Zul'jin. I get it. He's on the list. He's awesome. Can't say when he's coming. We had that one already. Will you ever allow cross-region transferable heroes? If not, why not?
That's a decision made pretty early on. I don't know that we'll ever revisit that, but I think if people talk about that, we will talk about it. But I no promises there for sure.
Okay. New minion changes and catapult changes. Are you happy with them so far? Because now they do more damage. Catapult ignores other stuff. Goes for the core.
I think we're happy with them. What do you think about them?
I'm happy with them.
Yeah?
Yeah, I like it.
What do these guys think about them?
There's more specialist meta. I don't know like what the general consensus is, but I think the changes have been pretty good because there's more like tactical rotation. I feel like that one actually... did a lot to counter the stun meta because I kind of had to reorder the way when I was casting the tournament yesterday. Mm-hmm. What makes a good draft? Like Leoric, Zagara, Chen is apparently a good draft, even though it doesn't have any stunts because they can control the map.
Yeah.
People like it. Great change. Seems good. Love it. Okay. Well done.
All right.
Compliment.
Well, cool. I'll go pat those guys on the back. All right.
We heard something about an MVP system.
Yeah.
So a reward for the top performing player. In terms of rank adjustment, in terms of maybe hidden MMR award, how can you possibly reward a player when it could possibly incentivize people that take heroes, that score well?
Sure.
Once they understand your system, they may find out that Nazebo solo pushing, never dying, nonetheless not contributing as much to the team's general win chance.
Sure.
How is that? That's so difficult.
So I think we're talking about how personal performance can affect like your rating when you're done playing, right?
Yeah.
So we just announced an MVP system that's more of like acknowledging players who play well. Those two systems aren't necessarily tied together. They could be, but we'll have to see how that goes.
So to those who don't know exactly what MVP system is?
So MVP is us starting to scratch the surface of what we've been asked a lot for, which is like, how come I don't get any personal recognition? This is such a team-based game. You guys did a great job. You made a team-based game, but what about me? And I think we agree. We need to do a better job of that. So this is a system that at the end of the game, right after the victory screen, we're going to pull up one player, and we're going to look at their combined stats. And there's actually a pretty elaborate matrix that they've made to kind of the logic of
already made
of how we do that. So that's actually in the Machines of War patch. So that'll be on the PTR on the 29th of this month. That'll be going live the week of September 13th. So you guys will start seeing that. So we'll call it that one player. And it's not play of the game, because it's not about one moment. It's about the overall impact that player had on the game. And we're trying to call out literally the most valuable player, the person who had the most impact on the game. So it could be your team, it could be the enemy team.
Then or just one among the 10.
Yep. And then after that, that's like a full screen. And actually, there's videos of this. So if you guys haven't seen it, go check it out. It should have been released with everything else that we just did at Gamescom. But
why not one for each team?
I think because we were really looking at like who really was the best. So the next thing that happens though is four more people get called out for various things. Those secondary like callouts are much more about like a very specific thing. Like maybe they had the most kills or it's stats. And actually, there's a whole bunch of things we have now, and we're going to keep adding to it. So if you see this and you go, well, that's great, but it doesn't tell me about this thing, call it out. Like
this is testable on the PTR.
It will be testable on the PTR.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, but again, that's the beginnings of this. We really want to do a much better job at letting players know. And so I think the next phase of this will be getting a lot more stats into play, letting you see more like specific callouts of how you really performed well in the game.
That's very nice.
Yeah,
behind that.
But so that's MVP as we're calling it. And actually, that may be like the working title. We all may need to name it something else. But it literally is. It's calling out MVP, and there's these other things too, though. So, but the thing you're asking about is yes, taking that data or some other data set and saying, you lost, but you performed incredibly well. My MMR should not be as negatively impacted. My rank points shouldn't go down as much. We're talking about that system as well. I think that's a little dicier, and there's a lot of debate about that. But we see the value in that. I think a lot of games have shied away from that. So we're exploring that, and we're going to talk about the pros and cons and see if it's right for heroes.
Do you look a lot at other games to see what works for them?
Sure. I mean, we all are just a bunch of gamers who got lucky and get to make games.
You're then. Allowed to play non-Blizzard games internally.
Absolutely, yes. We're encouraged to do so. So, yeah, I think we look at things, and sometimes we see systems and they don't work for our game, but we like them, and we try to think about how would we pivot that, like what's the right answer for our game.
Okay.
But, yeah, we're always looking for cool stuff that works well.
Cool. Maximum amount of battlegrounds. Say you make another 7. When are you going to start phasing battlegrounds out? How are you going to phase them out? How do you choose those? Will it ever be up to a vote of the community? What do you think? What is the sweet spot?
Yeah, I don't really know the answer. I think as an existing player, I think even today with the number of battlegrounds we have, I think it's like my brain can manage it. As a new player, I think it's kind of overwhelming.
I was 40 games into Heroes of the Storm. I had never played a MOBA, and I still thought Dragonshire was Garden Terror and vice versa.
Yeah.
I kept asking my spouse, what's the objective here again? I had played it like four times already at Battleground.
So I think there's two things there. So one is, for brand new players coming into the game, they should probably not have 11 or 13 Battlegrounds that we're about to have. We should probably do something to kind of ease them in just a little bit, or at least provide them the option of being eased in so they're not just being slapped in the face with these Battlegrounds. And the way our matchmaking works is we try not to match you on the same battleground back to back, right? Like it's actually got logic in there that's trying to make sure you're playing a breadth of them. Yeah. So right now, when there's 10 or 11 battlegrounds in the pool, you're not going to get the same battleground again for days, maybe. Like it depends on how much you're playing, right?
So could be nice. Yeah.
Yeah, your ability today to try to like master a battleground is based on playing hundreds of games. And I mean, there's value in that, but I don't think that's a great new user experience. So
could you restrict the amount for new players or say, like, let's try to get you on Dragonshire 3 times in a row?
Yeah, and I think that's kind of the direction we're going to go. I think we'll try some of that and seeing how does that feel. Like, because one thing is, one of the huge advantages and what people come to our game for is, like, this is so cool, multiple battlegrounds. I wanted that. I always say, why do we play the same map in these other games? Like, I want something else. And maybe they saw a particular battleground. Like, if they see this content we showed here, we're showing StarCraft Battlegrounds, our latest ones. If they come in, though, and they can't play that one, that's going to kind of suck, too. Like, I came for the StarCraft Battleground. Where's that? So we're having conversations about that. How do we deal with it with new players? How do we deal with it with our veteran players? On the veteran side, we talked about map rotation. So, you know, we come from StarCraft 2 and WarCraft 3 and StarCraft. We have map rotations.
5, 7, 9.
Yeah, so I think our leaning right now is to implement something, and perhaps only in ranked play, but we're still talking about it, that would kind of like pick a pool of maps for a given season or something, and that would be the things that you play. And so that's kind of the leaning, but we're talking about that in both vectors, and it's hard because it's different solutions for two different audiences.
Okay.
We don't want to like screw over either one of them in the process of that. So we're trying to think of everybody, which is difficult.
Some people ask map vetoes. Why don't we have it like in StarCraft? Or I can answer already. It doesn't make sense if 10 people all veto a different map, then you only have 3 playable maps left, or 1.
Yeah,
but what do you think about vetoes?
So one of the biggest reasons we don't have it is that we have so many factors that are being figured in for matchmaking when you're doing a 5v5 game. And our top priority is to get you the best possible game you can get in the shortest amount of time. When we suddenly add this variable that like everyone can veto their least favorite maps or upvote their favorite maps or whatever, then it's another layer that we're having to balance against that at the end of the day may screw our matchmaking completely.
Sure.
And when we look at the data for it, it complicates it. So you wait way longer or you have worse matches, and none of us want to wait longer or have worse matches. So we're, you know.
Yeah, I think that's a very clear point.
Yeah, I get where they're coming from, and I think, too, coming from our other games where we've done this. We have map vetoes in StarCraft, but it's 1v1. Like, we just need to take 2 good players and put them against each other. That's it. Like,
yeah. Okay.
So we'll keep talking about it. We'll keep looking at it. Like I said, behind the scenes, the game is technically like vetoing maps for you in terms of trying to give you some variety of the maps.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
So the one thing I would say is that if you have a map you hate for whatever reason, at least you're not going to play it back-to-back in like consistent play sessions.
4 times in a row.
Yeah. So we've tried to help with that part of it, for better or worse, but I'm open to more feedback on that.
Okay. Haunted Minds. We have heard a tweet recently that it's working internally among Blizzard in a nice way.
Yep.
Can we know anything more about it or when it's coming potentially?
I'll just say that, you know, we took it out and we wanted to make improvements to it. We heard a lot of feedback. We tried to make some tweaks to it. It just didn't work before. I like it. It has problems, but I miss it in ways, so I'm excited to get it back. It's in test right now, so the testing.
Do you like the new one?
The new version of it. So.
Do you like the new one?
Oh, do I like it? Yeah. No, yeah. I think it's in a really good place, but. We have to get through the testing process, then we'll talk about when it comes back in, but we understand that people want it back. So it's
okay. There's a few questions here. I'm going to ignore them because they've already been answered. You can maybe check this back later, guys, on YouTube. Hero draft switching.
Yes.
Like very useful for Team League. Hero League is tempered with the potential of trolling.
Yeah.
What is your stance and your progress on it, potentially?
So we're talking about it. We want it... I think it's needed in places, but yeah, it's a dangerous thing. My personal preference, and this may not be representative of my team and everything else, like I keep thinking that if I'm in a party that I should always have like first come, first serve with my party so that we have some flexibility there. But you guys want the ability to like pick it and then mix and match, and it totally makes sense at the high end. So I could see us adding it for custom games or something so that it could be like for tournaments and things that we could use it that way.
That'd be nice.
I'm not sure about, I mean, we've worked so hard to try to minimize some of the friction points with community interaction, just the way people treat each other. I mean, there's a world where that works beautifully and everyone is great, and there's a world where it just makes it a total disaster. So
okay.
I don't know.
I understand.
We'll keep talking about it.
Yeah. Okay. I have a few more questions from before. Some people wonder about map editors. We've got a lot of creative people in the scene who would love to add their maps. Of course, we know that the MOBA genre itself came from a Blizzard game. StarCraft 1, Aeon of Strife, and then Defense of the Ancients in Warcraft 3. So will we ever have access to a map editor for Heroes?
We've been talking about it from very early on. I think it was always our goal to go there because that's where this all came from, and we love that. I mean, this game came from us making it as a mod for StarCraft 2. Like, that's why it's here. There's a lot of things as we explore that. There's a lot of things we talk about of how to, like, We can't just release our current editor. There would need to be a bunch of work that we do to try to create something that's specific to editing this game, which, you know, started off as a mod. It's now 2 separate teams, 2 separate tech stacks. Everything's kind of split off, but there's a lot of work for us to get it to a point where it would be like a fully function editor for Heroes. So priorities, once again, we're looking at like, should we redo ranked play or should we do that? It's like ranked play is 100%. And as we move through that list, I think it's hard for us to get that prioritized.
Okay.
I like the idea of, if exposing at least some things like you're talking about with custom games that we talked about earlier, of if we can give some switches and controls that let players have some options, or at least they get to control the gameplay. Maybe they want to mess around with cooldowns or death timers or hero level or
no cooldowns, double damage,
whatever. Like
three Zaryas in one game.
I think that's a good stepping stone and can maybe help offer something more we have today, which is nothing in that regard. So
I like
that idea. I'm personally very passionate about that. I started at Blizzard with Warcraft 3 and watched all this stuff happen. Yeah. Yeah, I know. Yeah, you're. It's so cool, like, to be here with you, actually, after all these years of watching you.
Super cool. Yeah.
Awesome.
I met Chris Siggity already in 2003. He was there in the audience. He's the first Blizzard employee I ever met, and he was sitting there watching his own game. I'm like, why are you watching your own game? It's like, it's so cool what you guys are doing with the game.
Yeah.
Super
love
cool.
That. Yeah. Thank
you. Got a few other things. Right now, if you are unlucky in a certain pattern with a certain favoriteness or unfavoriteness, you can get in a position where you lose two or three games, win one, lose two or three, and win one. Actually, that would be the lucky variant. But anyway, you could win two, lose one, win two, lose one, and never promote.
Yeah.
Because you could have like 995 out of 1,000 points. So is there any plans to change this?
Yeah, so there's a couple of things that we're talking about. There's like this idea of some loss mitigation. There's also the personal performance side of it. So I think if we go the route that if you do really well in a game that you could actually not have to lose as many points when you for a loss, I think that might help that. I definitely like it's like the luck of the draw getting stuck in that cycle, and it sucks when it happens. Like you just feel like you're stagnant, but it's worse than that because you're working really hard to be stagnant. So I understand that, and it's something that we're aware of and talking about, and we'll try to find an elegant solution, but we'll probably be chipping away at it.
Okay, so the new rank system, I think it's much better than the previous one.
Cool.
Do you think it's are you personally satisfied with it? Are you still making changes on it? When are you planning on rolling out changes, if so?
Yeah, so I think we're off to a good start. I think it's much better. This is actually our third iteration on ranked. We've redone it 3 times now. And it's interesting because we're kind of back to something much more like what we had in StarCraft 2. So it just tells you, like,
certain fundamentals that work.
Yeah, and you think you know like something that's going to work, and it just doesn't. Like, and this happens all the time. In life, in game development, this will continue to happen. But I think we have a better foundation for a system now. And I like seasons because they give us opportunities to keep iterating on it. And I think you can expect season over season to have us make ranges of changes from little tiny things to pretty big impactful ones all along the way. And it's really important that we hear feedback from you guys and from everybody playing the game about what's working and what's not working. For season two, which actually season two is going to begin with the Machines of War launch here on the week of September 13th when it goes live, there's some change that's going into that where we're not going to be throwing away. Like right now, you lose points when you're kind of at the extent, like right at promotion.
Right. So let's say you need you're at 990, you need 1,000, you get only 10, and then you play your promotion game. So you lose maybe 160 to 200 points.
Yeah, a lot of points that could have been very helpful to guard you against some of this other phenomenon that you're talking about later, right?
A bit more of a buffer or something.
Yeah. So we're going to be banking those points and giving, whether you win or lose, we're going to give them back to you. So at least you earn them, you're going to get them.
Oh.
And actually, I just said that's coming with season two. Please don't quote me on that because I'm
not sure if it's coming.
I have jet lag and I'm disconnected, but it's coming though.
Okay.
I hope it's there, but if not, it will be there soon.
Okay, but at least it's you're aware of the potential frustration people can have with that.
Sure.
And it's coming relatively soon.
We agree in it. We've actively already worked on it. I'm not sure where it launches in that time frame.
Okay. Very cool. Nice. I'm stuck on lower league since alpha. It's not my fault. I cannot possibly be bad.
I hear this a lot.
Yeah. There's also a psychological element. Thank you for illustrating that I'm not the swarm. let's see. Some people wonder if there's going to be any other events. We've had the Diablo event. We've had a StarCraft event. We haven't had a Warcraft event, right?
Nope.
Okay, but we have Warcraft. It's in the cards, right? It's not like we're never going to do that.
No, I think we like this. Like the beauty of this game, we have a bunch of like people working on our team that love Blizzard games. We came to Blizzard because we love Blizzard games. We all have our favorites. We all have characters that resonate with us and worlds and music. Like all these things that are really like meaningful to us. And this game is our place, our playground to get to bring all that stuff together. And it's such a unique opportunity. And I don't know, our whole team feels really lucky to kind of have this world to play in, the Nexus, and we get to peel off the rules. We get to just do what we want and kind of bring it all together. So you're definitely going to see Warcraft coming in. You're definitely going to see Overwatch coming in. You know, we did the Eternal Conflict was the Diablo event that we brought the Diablo maps in. We did that one. We did it over a really long period of time. It was like a 3-month period. When we were done, we all kind of sit back, and I think the community too was like, that's a lot of Diablo. Like, that's kind of a lot. So we're compressing it a lot more now. and trying to get it. It's, again, the patches are 2 weeks apart, so you'll get two battlegrounds. You're going to get Alarak. And everyone's like, Zarya's not a StarCraft hero. So our feeling there was, we're really excited about Overwatch. We want to get more Overwatch characters in. She's sci-fi. She fits the theme. Like, a lot of what's exciting about bringing StarCraft in is that we get to bring this awesome sci-fi world, and it happens to be the one that we've created and that we love ourselves.
Must be really fun to work on Heroes of the Storm. You can use all the theme music, all the best theme music ever, all the characters. So creative.
Yeah, so it's really cool now. You like listen to the music when you went to the Diablo 1, and now looking at what we're doing here with Machines of War for StarCraft. You know, we have like Glenn Stafford still works on the music for Heroes of the Storm. Glenn did the music going back to like StarCraft 1, and like he's been here forever. And so some of these things are the original people who worked on some of this stuff are still here working on it and reinterpreting it and adding to it to keep Heroes going. And it's kind of amazing to bring everybody together, and we're all just kind of geeking out over Blizzard games, and we get to do Heroes.
Yeah, as am I. Yeah. Very cool. Let's see. I have a few more here. How many reworks do you think you can roughly handle, like, per, let's say, month period? Like, is there a kind of schedule there?
Yeah, so we're bound by a couple things on that. Like, you've seen us do a spectrum of reworks, from like small balance changes to complete talent overhauls, changing heroic abilities. So just, it depends. We are like going through the roster, though. We prioritize it, and we're looking at underutilized heroes. We're looking at win rates. We're looking at pick rates. Like, all these things come into play, and I think you can expect us to keep consistently hitting them. Like, we just recently had a couple patches ago where we touched talents for like a ridiculous number of characters, and the validation of that was super intense. I think it's a lot to gather to like absorb as players, and also introduces a lot of danger in terms of bugs, which it did, and it introduces bugs. So
I think they're mostly fixed at
this point, but we're talking, yeah. It's been a little while. So
yeah.
We don't like doing that. We don't like breaking the game while we're trying to fix the game, but it's kind of just inherent. So I think we have to do that, we got to pace ourselves enough to not screw things up along the way.
Okay.
And we'll try really hard to do that, but we have a dedicated balance team that they're looking at this stuff all the time, and they have tons of stuff that they're testing. They try different things. Sometimes it sticks, sometimes it doesn't. So we got to get through that process. Then we actually have to validate it all, and then we get it to you. But expect us to continue doing that, like, forever.
Wow. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. One thing a lot of people wonder about, guilds and clans.
Yeah.
Is there going to be a way for us to have them, simply put?
We're excited about them. I think we keep kind of talking about, we made this awesome team game, and then there's not a lot of mechanisms in our team game to help you find a team. Right now, there's a party finder, and I think people would agree that sometimes it works and sometimes it really doesn't work. But we need a lot more than that. So we've had clans and guilds in our other games, and we like them a lot. We didn't get them in Heroes initially. StarCraft has done some work now for them, so we get to leverage some of their work and some of the technology to kind of give us a starting point. It's a little different. Like, we have different plans for it. But we've been talking about it for a really long time. We've actually had a couple different ideas along the way. We're getting through a bunch of big work right now, and I think that's probably the next big social feature that we really want to look at is guilds and clans, like whatever we end up calling
that. The next social feature.
But like a structure that is like, help me find like-minded people, preferably of equal skill or in my range, that I can get together and play this game with and hopefully start building meaningful relationships with, getting teams together, playing Team League. At the end of the day, we think Team League is the way to play this game.
Yeah.
But you got to have four people to play with, and if you don't, you're not going to get to experience that. So we'd like to help people find that.
Maybe I should play more Team League too. I always enjoy it. Yeah. It is difficult sometimes, yes, to find people to get together for a Team League. It's easy for me. I just say, like, four people raise their hands, but not always as easy for everyone. Okay.
Well,
okay.
I think it's about consistency too, like building a group of people that you can play with on a regular basis and start and getting to know each other in a way that you start getting that sixth sense about how that person's going to react.
Yeah, yeah. Very cool. So on the launcher, there is an alpha voice chat functionality.
Yeah.
Which seems like maybe it could open the door to voice chat in Heroes of the Storm.
Definitely. So Overwatch came out and has integrated voice chat. We've actually had integrated voice chat in both World of Warcraft and StarCraft 2 before. Not a lot of people use it. Most people had their own preferred versions, and for whatever reason, whether it's because they were already using it or because their guild used it or whatever,
I'm not a big fan of this game, but I like your WC3 streams and streams
right
now.
We recognize that most people
don't
want to talk to pugs
You're
and stuff
best.
With it. Or maybe you do, maybe you don't. It opens up some danger once again for people who don't like
I
to
I want
be.
To talk to all the nice people and not to the not nice people. Can you make that happen?
Filter me only to nice people.
Okay.
So the thing that's in the Battle.net client right now that's being tested is like... It's the same technology that Overwatch is using, but it's shared. I actually kind of like it in the Battle.net client because when I'm using it in the alpha test right now, but I have groups of people that I play with across a whole bunch of Blizzard games, and we can be having a conversation outside of the games and switching games, and it's pretty smooth. We have plans to do integrated voice chat for Heroes. All the rules that everyone's worried about with how do I control who I talk to, and I don't want to talk to people, or I want to talk to everyone because I want to give them all crap and flame them or whatever.
Are going to be incorporative of that.
We'll have to deal with all that, but okay. But I think you can expect us first to have the Battle.net one that everyone can use, so that will be there for you. That, again, is only good if you have friends that you're using it with. The other one would be, is there some way to opt into chat in the game that's integrated?
Okay. Someone asked about replays. Replay system received some improvements. Is it possible to ever watch, for example, replays together?
Yeah, so... I think we have.
Oh, yeah, we watched replays together already.
Yeah, I think we have that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we did something.
Yeah.
Is it possible to watch replays maybe like at a somewhat faster speed because there's a bit of performance?
So the simulation speed is a problem. That's the same reason that rejoining is slow, is that we're waiting for the game to simulate all that information and get it back. So there's a lot of different things we talk about of how do we address that. We've made some incremental improvements. I recognize they're still not where you want it, still not where we want it. Some things to make that dramatically improved are like fundamental changes to some of our low-level systems that it's a huge amount of work. Mm. So we're looking for opportunities of how do we get better without having to completely reinvent the wheel. And so I think you'll see us trying to push at that. I know that it's not enough progress fast enough. I hear you. I'm sorry. Like, well, we're trying.
We get a sense already of the big mountain of priorities that there must be. But just, you know, people... want to know basically everything. Everyone has their own favorite feature.
Yeah, no, I totally understand. Yeah. I share your feelings on it. Okay. Absolutely.
Okay. This is a bit more of a game balance thing, I suppose. Not sure if you can answer, but Rhaegar was removed with his ancestral healing, but there's three other supports who can still protect themselves. Uther, Karazim, Auriel.
Sure.
Is it purely a balance thing, or is there a part of the design where you think, like, well, ancestral self doesn't make sense, so we're going to keep it that way?
Yeah, I don't know that I'm the best person to answer this. Yeah. I hear bits and pieces of some of the rationale behind a decision like this, but I can't do it. I think this is something we could probably put forward and get an answer out there on the forums or Reddit or something for you guys, because it's a good question.
Sure. Watch tab. UI team will have to come in, esports team. There's a lot of different things. Is there a plan to bring tournaments into the client where you can just be like, oh, there's a tournament going on, click, open?
We think that's a really cool feature.
It sounds so simple when I say it that way, right?
It's super, and that's like how I am as a producer. I'll go, it's really easy. Just bring that thing in there. You guys can do that. It's rarely that easy, but
yeah.
I think we think that's a cool feature. We see that elsewhere. We like it. We think it's really cool. We are like like inching our way to trying to get better support for that. Like, we do the home screen takeovers now when we have live esports events. I'm really glad we have that. And it's at least like bringing some awareness in the client. If I'm playing the game, I'm like, I didn't even know that was going on. Let's go check it out.
Yeah.
But I think that idea of being able to watch tournaments like that, of being able to jump in and watch your friends, like spectating, is cool. I come into the game every night and everybody I know is in a game and I'll like, do I play a game?
So spectator friend
is
much desired feature for you guys internally.
I think we would like to have that. Yeah, that's a bunch of work. And it's a bunch of work on some of the teams that are the most impacted teams. So priorities come in again. I don't know. Like, again, I wouldn't have pushed ranked play revamp for spectating. I wouldn't have done that. So those are the kind of calls we have to make. But I want it.
Completely different question. I've got about 180,000 gold banked up.
Nice.
Will there be... nice. I would share it. No, I can't share it with you guys. Will there ever be a mount that costs 200,000 gold just to show how elite I am?
I've talked about that stuff, but I think it seems like a funny thing, and I have a lot of gold as well. Like, I've played a lot, and I've accumulated a lot of gold. But I think as much as like that sounds really cool to some players, I think it sounds really uncool to other players. So
what?
I don't know.
Trickslayer says, give me your gold. All right.
Let's
just say the message that counts, I'll give you 5,000 gold, Trickslayer, if it was possible. Don't do it, greedy bully.
Yeah.
No, I can see the envy of the people that don't have 200,000 gold. So I can see where you're coming from. All right.
I don't. That doesn't mean that we won't make like really cool mounts like that. But I think it doesn't feel good if you happen to not have a lot of gold.
Accessible for people, right?
If we do that, we have to have some other way to get that. So maybe in a world where we have another mechanism for getting that, that becomes an option.
Okay. Just going to address something that a lot of people are very passionate about. You guys are asking about Arena. I've already asked them that. You can find it on the earlier part of the interview. But basically, it's still planned for this year. It's different than it was at BlizzCon 2015. It's still coming. And we'll know more about it soon. Without the TM.
It's coming.
Pretty cool. Kirby asks if they will make gift for heroes.
Gifting
people. I read something in your previous interview that you said it's a little bit more difficult than what people think. Like to set it up. Again, a feature that needs a lot of work.
It's a bunch of work. It's a work both on our team and off our team. There's work for Battle.net and work for us. So that's one of the things with cross-team dependencies where it's even more complicated than our own priorities. We got to balance it across the priorities of the company and other teams. I think we like the idea of it. If I could have it now, I would have it. I like the ability to do that. I would buy a ton of stuff. Like I would spend all my gold I have banked to buy things for people, and I would do that. So
is it just a development and UI thing that would hold it back just with the amount of work that you have? Or is it also something about someone in Russia should not be able to buy for someone in, I don't know, Singapore?
And we always,
because of like legality or whatever.
You always have to get down, and there's something having to do with that side of it.
Yeah.
But usually that's easier to deal with than
the
implementation side of it. But
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think it's on the list. When we talk about the hundreds of things that we would like to do, it's definitely on there.
Okay. Wow. Sunlight. Man.
It's daytime.
Physics. Okay, what about something like Paragon levels, which you have in Diablo?
Yeah.
You get to level 20 on a hero, get some kind of reward or progression system there, because some people feel that after they play their favorite hero the most, oh my god, son, after you play your favorite hero the most, you are inversely incentivized to play it further.
I agree with that. So I think we need to go back to the progression system as a whole. I think we had some cool stuff in it, like the 1 to 10 journey for a hero progression feels really good. You get lots of little unlocks and rewards along the way. Then you hit 10, it slows down a lot. There's a couple meaty gold rewards, but they're few and far between. And yes, when you hit 20, which I have Nazebo at 20. I know some people who play a lot more than me have a lot more than that at 20. But
I don't have a level 20 yet.
You don't?
No, I play like so many different characters, but I'm also consciously avoiding it.
Yeah.
Because I want to be able to play each one, but if I'm 20, I'm like, I lose a bit of XP.
Yeah, so for me, it's weird. It's that weird thing where, if you're like disincentivized to play your favorite hero, that sucks. I don't want it to be like that. So we want to revamp the progression system as a whole. I think it's been something we've wanted to do for a while. And when we do that, look for us to be saying, how can we make sure that no matter what hero you're playing, what mode you're playing, that you have some mechanisms to make meaningful progress and get cool rewards along the way? Like, that's the ideal, right? Like, you gotta try to get there. So that's the thing that to me is a higher priority. Like, I think getting a thing in where I can make meaningful progress and I don't have to feel like I should stop playing my favorite hero, because it's like the opposite of what I want everyone to be doing. Like, go play your favorite hero. Like, have fun.
Okay, so the will is there. It's relatively high on the priority list.
Yeah, I think that's a big one.
Okay, cool. Quests. Yeah, some people... I used to think that it's good that the quest system forces you to play a certain role, because, well, I get to a hero league and I don't want to feel like I'm with a group of four players who all say adamantly, I don't own any supports, I don't have any, I don't know how to play them. So having support quests incentivizes them to play them at least a little.
Yeah.
However, some people, stubborn, or maybe they really just, they'll do it if they have to, but they don't feel like it on that day. Can they sack a quest, just like in Hearthstone, get it replaced once a day? Will that ever happen?
So I think we have like a couple phases to this. The first thing that we're going to be doing here is we're having a system that, again, I want to say it's in this patch, but don't quote me on it. I think it is, though. That will make it so that you can fulfill any quest requirement when you're playing like draft mode. So that you don't have to feel like you're cornered. So there's one way. So it won't let you like. And actually, I think it's actually better for you guys. Like,
and when you say draft mode, do you mean custom game or?
No. So like, if in ranked play, it may work in unranked draft as well. I think it may just be in ranked play though. So let me try to get more info. I know Trixler's in the chat, but it's Saturday, so I don't know that he has access to other people to be able to ask these questions and verify the crazy things that I say. But yeah, so the idea though is you won't be able to dismiss quests necessarily, but you'll be able to fulfill quest requirements even if you're in ranked mode without.
I think that's already possible. I want to say like you can already play either quick match unranked or ranked to complete your quest.
No, but this is like you get a quest that says play a support, and you're going to get credit for playing a support even if you don't play a support.
Oh.
Yeah.
How?
We're going to do that. We'll do that for you.
So it's not deletion because this is just easier to manipulate on the back end?
This is an easier thing. But like I said, it works out better for you guys because there's...
So ranked is a wild card is what you're saying. It's a joker implementable.
What that may mean, though, is you might have multiple quests and you're fulfilling multiple quests with the same games, which is better than what you have today.
Okay.
So I think that's a win.
Except, like, it just sounds like it doesn't make sense, but is it just, like, because that's easier to implement?
Everyone says it doesn't make sense.
I'm not sure if there's something we don't get yet. Like, I play an assassin in ranked, but because it's ranked, you forgive that it's not a support. You complete the support quest anyway.
Yeah.
Why not just delete the support quest and make it an assassin quest if, you know, I want to do that?
Well, because if you had the ability to delete it, you'd still get a random roll of that other quest. Yeah. We don't want to punish you for playing ranked play, and we don't want to make you make bad decisions in ranked play because you were trying to get gold in the quest system.
But you know what's going to happen? Someone is going to be like, oh, I just completed that. I didn't play support. Is it broken?
People will probably think that.
Yeah.
But I think they probably are not going to call us and complain about getting credit for a quest that they didn't.
I think it's going to happen. Yeah, maybe not because it's like advantageous, but people are going to wonder, I think, repeatedly.
Sure. So how should we get that information out, you think?
It can just be like, you can just write play support or play ranked.
I think you'll probably say that.
That'll be good.
But not everybody reads stuff, unfortunately. But I think that part will be there.
Yeah, but then you can have your community answer the question for you. Every time there's going to be someone on Reddit that says, I just played a support, but I got an assassin quest. They're like, read the tooltip, dude. And then you have like a self-policing solving of the problem rather than infinite confusion.
Sure.
Okay, maybe we'll have that.
It will definitely be in the tooltip.
Okay.
I haven't seen a lot of luck with tooltips. Okay. I agree with the self-policing. It's good to have someone else say, yes, it's working, fine.
That's why I have moderators, so they can self-police themselves every time someone steps out of line or acts silly. I'll say something once, and then they can help each other. All right. Cool. That makes sense. Ask if it's possible. More information in match history. Statistics, player battle tags.
So we talked about a little bit earlier. So MVP is our first like touching this thing of like give me some indication of what happened and what I'm doing. The next step is to kind of get a lot more about personal stats and exposing a lot more data, revamping the score screen so you have a lot more meaningful information there that you can use as a gauge for how you did, how that stacks up against other things that you've done. So look for us to keep going more and more in that direction.
Okay. So recently we've seen a number of heroes come out that personally I'm very happy with.
Sure.
For example, I don't think Alarak, from my first look, which is often wrong, is super strong yet, but in terms of his talent kit, most of it anyway, and his core design, I think he's difficult to use, and he can really hit a power spike with good skill. Many other heroes have been like this as well. For example, Tracer, Medivh. Do you also have a chance to or a wish to bring out more Lilies? Or are you only catering to the high... skill request.
I think there's been a big push to try to make sure we're adding in higher skill cap heroes, and I think they've been doing a really good job bringing that in.
So for now, you want to give in to that?
You're seeing, right, like when we release a hero today, this is a hero that we started 6-7 months ago.
Oh,
like
yeah.
The end-to-end time frame for a hero is really long, and most of that is about playtesting and iteration, and like we're just really pouring a lot into them. But I think... it's not our desire to just only make those kind of heroes. I think we want to have easy-to-play heroes, and I think it's important that we have them. So we should see us balance that out. You should see us not be so like consistently on one type. Like ideally, the whole game's about choice, about trying to give players the play experience that they're looking for. We want to give them the types of heroes that they want, the roles that they want. So we're going to try to balance all that out. And
okay.
It's just we've been on a little bit of a tear getting in those harder-to-play heroes.
Okay. Well, I'm personally happy with that because I think there's also a lot of talents, very clever, intelligent design about the way the talents work that allow you to just use them AFK mode. For example, the new spell shield, you can just leave it on. and it'll function just like before. Yep. Or you can toggle it off and turn it on right when you want to. That's, I think, pretty good mix of pro play and still casual allowance.
I think that's a really good example of that direction when they can do something really cool like that actually helps both sides of our player base.
Okay, very cool. One thing some people would like to see, for example, in Quick Match is being able to choose a role and then auto-select off of that. Selective auto-select, let's say. Is this in the cards?
We've talked about that. I'm like in a world where I look at I play the game every day, the live game, and then I play the game at work every day, and I play different flavors of the game at work because we have multiple branches and development and all this stuff going on. I'm having a hard time differentiating between where the reality line is, something that's in the game now versus something that's about to come out versus something that we're screwing around with and that no one should know about because we're just screwing around with it. So I'll say that we've taken some steps already to try to improve auto select and make it better in multiple ways. There's more coming on that. So I don't know if it'll get you everything that you're asking for there in terms of the logic of it, but I think we'll keep trying to make it better.
Okay. And then what about, for example, choosing my favorite skin and then auto-selecting and having that skin for the hero if I roll it?
I think that sounds cool, too. I think that's something that we hear, and that makes sense to me as part of us revamping that system and trying to add some more coolness to it for you guys.
What if there's people that don't want that? They want a random skin as well. Can you, toggle that?
Yeah, I mean, I think when you start talking about this, you start opening up this big thing on auto-select, and it's all the configuration options. Maybe that's a good thing. It's more UI stuff, so I think if we do that, you'll see us inching into it because it's probably not like a big system we want to do. It's something we want to try to make incrementally better as we have time to do it.
Okay. All right. I think I'll probably just do one more question. I'll look for the best one from the chat, and then I will release you from this very grateful interview for us. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm happy to be here.
Let's see. Maybe two. Okay. One is if you have a bot on your team, can you have a positive rank adjustment? If you someone goes AFK at minute 3, you play 15 minutes, you feel like you're certainly going to lose. I understand you cannot take away all loss points. Could be abusable. It's like, hey guys, I'll just leave and all of you won't lose anything. I don't know, something like that. But Can it be like a small adjustment?
Yeah, I think we're talking, as part of the loss forgiveness stuff, I think it wants to take into account things like that. If you were at a significant disadvantage for something that's completely out of your control, whether that's disconnects or people being trolly or whatever, we want to try to ease that a little bit, and it is kind of a dangerous area because there's lots of ways that people can then really, really take advantage of that. But I think there's stuff like that coming.
Okay, cool. Oh yeah, is there a chance that? I think this is really going to be my last one, and I hope I'll ever be able to have a talk with you again about this. But for now, is there a chance that when Arena comes out, you phase out another ranked, another game mode? Like, would it maybe replace Quick Match, or would you be very comfortable with four modes?
I don't think so. I think we'd have to watch it. Like, if it created problems, we could do things like only turn it on periodically or something, so that just creates moments. But I think our desire is to just have them all up, and we'll see how the traffic patterns go. Like, unranked draft's been really cool because actually a lot of people migrated from Quick Match to unranked draft. But
can we know how many?
I don't even think I know how many, but it was a good number. When we were originally talking about it, one of the reasons we held off on a while was there's a lot of debate. We're like, do people want to play this mode? Like,
I didn't want to play it, I thought.
Yeah.
I was like, people are going to troll in unranked draft.
Yeah.
Whatever negligence you see to respecting the team comp in ranked is going to be completely exacerbated in unranked.
Yeah.
People are just going to every time not play support. Turns out people, even without rank points, still like to win and play legit games. And I actually found Unranked Draft to be really good.
I really like Unranked Draft. Yeah, and so that was something where it's like, oh, cool. Because I remember Dustin over and over again, it's like, would you play Unranked Draft if we put it in? And we're like, yeah. We're like, but are you going to do bad things in it? And everyone's like, no. But it didn't. So I think that's been really good. But I think, Quick Match, you can still play Quick Match. It hasn't destroyed Quick Match that's there. And the fact that actually, even when we did the new Ranked update, with season 1 and even the end of the preseason, our mega preseason that we had, a lot of people went and play a lot more ranked, and they played a lot more team league because the rewards for our ranked system are a lot easier to get if you play team league.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people just were trying to pull pugs together to go play team league and get their ranks. But all those things so far have been okay. It hasn't been a big impact, but we'll have to watch it when it comes, see just how it goes.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Kaéo Milker from the Blizzard dev team. Thank you very much for your time. It was a true pleasure to have you on. Thank you for all the answers, and good luck everything else you do at the Gamescom.
Thanks so much, Grubby.
All right. See you, man.
Bye, guys.
troubled them.
Vengeance is mine. Is this the best healing you can do?
Vital signs.
Onward. Makes me wish I had a lighter.
Cool. Cool, cool, cool.